Our next speaker is Magnus von Knebel-Döberitz, Director of the Department for Applied Tumor Biology, who will give a talk on the immune biology of DNA mismatch repair deficient tumors.
Thanks very much. And thanks for inviting me to this very interesting, stimulating conference. What I would like to do in the next 20 minutes is to discuss with you a couple of aspects that we have outlined in a very specific mutational pathway, but that might prove true at the end to a broad variety of different cancers. And as you all know, carcinomas arise through changes of the genome. And changes of the genome have to be caused by very systematic initial events that introduce what we call genomic instability. Genomic instability can be addressing the structure and the number of chromosomes, and it can address specifically more minute alterations within the genome in terms of altering specific sequences within the tumor. One very important example for that is the phenomenon of microsatellite instability that occurs in about 5 to 10% of all carcinomas. And in that mechanism, the chromosomal structure, the numbers of the chromosomes, and the overall chromosomal content remains more or less constant. But on the sequence level, dramatic changes occur simply because the DNA mismatch repair that is mediated by a fairly complex enzyme system is lost in these cells, and this leads to the accumulation of single insertions or deletions and sensitive target sequences, which are usually repetitive DNA sequences, or what we call microsatellites, which are normally mononucleotide repeats somewhere in the genome. Now imagine if that happens in certain genes, you might definitely alter the protein function, because then there is a frame shift, and this has been known for quite some while, because microsatellite unstable cancers are characterized by very specific biological features. The most prominent ones that has been identified early was the substantial infiltration of those tumors with T cells, suggesting that there is a very strong immune response involved in the pathogenesis of these tumors. And it was also reflected by a fairly good prognosis of the patients, which was substantially different from carcinomas that develop through chromosomal instability pathways. So you can see here the MSI high cancers. Patients survive substantially better than those that were developed through chromosomal instability and didn't show this phenotype. In the clinic, about 15% of colorectal cancers are affected by this mutational pathway. About 30% of endometrial cancers are affected by this pathway. The majority of them is induced by changes of the methylation pattern of the genome, leading to a B allelic inactivation of the of genes that are involved in DNA mismatch repair. And a couple of them are also occurring in form of a hereditary condition, which became known as the Lynch syndrome, or hereditary non-polyposis colorectal carcinoma, which is by far the most prevalent inherited cancer predisposition syndrome we know so far. Interestingly, both occur through the very same mechanism, inducing a lot of these obviously antigenic cancers. Now, if you look now on the sequence, what happens actually in genes that are affected by this mutational pathway, the mutational pattern might affect coding areas that encompass microsatellite sequences, coding for a couple of phenylalanines, for example, based on an A or T repeat. And then this leads to an insertion or deletion of one of these nucleotides in the coding region. And the consequence of that mutation would be that you end up with a truncated protein that usually encodes in its 3' end a neopeptide sequence that is simply induced through the frame shift that is triggered by that specific mutational mechanisms. So we can expect that this is not simply a mutation of the gene and activating the protein function, but it really induces something that is totally different to the organism, because it just occurs in these initiated lesions that have already acquired the state of microsatellite instability due to the loss of the DNA mismatch repair capacity. Now, this year, a couple of analyses about the foreignness of cancers became quite important because of the awareness that by DNA, by immune checkpoint blockade, a number of cancers can be treated quite well. And obviously, these microsatellite unstable cancers are a very prominent example for these immunological interactions because they have a fairly high rate of highly immunogenic mutations. And the consequence is that these are particularly sensitive to checkpoint blockade, as has been shown by Vogelstein's group and many others. And they are actually a primary target here. And this is also seen on the mutational landscape that these cancers that develop in the endometrium, in the stomach, or the colorectum are obviously presumably relating to the ones that show this mutational pathway. There's another very important point about these mutations because they are frame shifts. They really trigger substantial parts of foreign peptides, longer peptides, compared to the ones that are just induced by a single amino acid exchange that usually occurs in P53 mutations or many others. So we can expect that these tumors and this particular pathway really induces very strong antigens during its pathogenesis. The next question then is, can we identify proteins that are involved in a responsible way in the carcinogenesis of these tumors? And if you would find those proteins, we could trace back to specific patterns of peptides that need to be generated for a cancer so that the cancer can grow as a cancer because it affects mutations that have some kind of driver function in the pathogenesis. And to ask this question, we were looking for genes that are systematically affected by this mutational pathway in independently occurring tumors which arise through microsatellite instability. So to do so, and this traces back in the pre-genomic area, so we started with a project in 1997 and earlier, we were looking together with a group of Per Borg from the EMBL for genes that are actually carrying these microsatellite or coding microsatellites, identified then a high number of genes that might have potentially been affected. And from those, we looked in a series of biopsies for candidates, how often they show in independently occurring tumors this type of mutations. And then we predicted the frameshift peptides from the sequence analysis and could identify a series of peptides that we could then test for their potential immunogenicity by simply using or synthesizing these theoretically predicted peptides and testing in vitro then their immune response in patients who are affected by these microsatellite tumors. And of course, at the end, we were asking why do tumors arise if patients are actually developing an immune response. So to make a very long story quite short, and many people were involved in this work, we identified a series of genes that show mutations in the respective genes in a higher frequency than what we would have statistically expected, suggesting that those genes have some kind of driver effect for the selection and Darwinistic evolution of the respective tumors. Interestingly, some of them have been known tumor suppressor genes, as for example the TGF-beta receptor type 2 or a couple of others, clearly showing that there's obviously something that provides an advantage to the tumor if such a mutation occurs in these tumors. So by doing that, we were then able to select a number of mutations that are overrepresented in the growing cancers. Of course, there are many other frameshift mutations induced by the very same mechanism, but because those wouldn't provide the respective tumor cell clone an advantage, they are neglectable or of no further clinical interest. And we focus really on the genes that are consistently expressed in independently occurring cancers, suggesting that they have some kind of driver function. And what turned out then was that in cancers that develop through this microsatellite instability pathway, the lymphocytes that have been histologically already classified years before were indeed reactive towards these theoretically predicted peptides, as we did analyze by ELISpot analysis from either tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes, but we found the very same lymphocytes also in the peripheral blood, clearly suggesting that patients who are developing this type of tumor through this mutational pathway are also developing an immune response against these tumors. Then the question arises, why do these tumors grow? One further interesting observation was that in the hereditary conditions, the Lynch syndrome, where patients are affected by a genetically acquired precondition for developing cancer, the penetrance of that disease is only less than 50%. Maximum 0.5%, or a half of the patients who are affected by these germline conditions develop an microsatellite unstable cancer. So the question arises, do these patients potentially develop lesions that are microsatellite unstable? Do the immune system of the respective patients potentially sees and learns about these antigens and potentially develops some kind of immune surveillance mechanism that eradicates then these cell clones before they get the chance to become an invasive carcinoma? And the analysis of patients who develop microsatellite unstable cancers, as well as healthy gene carriers, relatives to the ones that developed here these carcinomas, but who never developed in their lifetime so far to the time point of the investigation, a tumor, they clearly showed the same pattern of immune response based on T cells that we measured on the ELISpots against this group of theoretically predicted frameshift peptides, clearly suggesting that in these healthy individuals, something develops that teaches their immune system that there is an ongoing immune response, and potentially that immune response was responsible for the fact that those patients did not yet develop an invasive carcinoma. Now the question is how to identify these lesions, and this was joint work of Matthias Klohr and Henrik Bleker in the Institute of Pathology. They were looking actually in the normal mucosa next to microsatellite unstable cancers of patients who were affected by the Lynch syndrome, who had this inherited condition, whether they could identify totally normal-looking crypts that potentially already showed the molecular feature of microsatellite instability. And they succeeded to describe a type of crypt that lost the DNA mismatch repair capacity, shown as the lack of staining for the components of the DNA mismatch repair capacity or the DNA mismatch repair complexes, clearly suggesting that these clones already lost the DNA mismatch repair functions, and by molecular analysis they could even show that they are already microsatellite unstable, but potentially have not yet acquired the combination of mutations that allow them then to grow as a carcinoma. But clearly here's something that shows that there is an early precondition or pre-neoplastic lesion that can't be identified by just normal pathology, but fulfills the molecular criteria and presumably already presents the frameshift antigens on their surface, explaining why those patients have already developed an immune response without having yet developed an invasive carcinoma. And if you then calculate the number of those crypts, they are, at least in the Lynch syndrome patients, in the gut of the Lynch syndrome patients, really prevalent features, so they occur in thousands and ten thousands of the crypts distributed all over the complete gastrointestinal mucosa. If that's the fact, then we thought it would be wise to train the immune system, particularly of Lynch syndrome patients, about these frameshift mutations, and thinking of something that could be used as a really preventive vaccine before patients who are affected by this inherited condition start to develop these scripts or even start to develop growing pre-neoplastic lesions that then might progress to invasive carcinomas. On the other hand, the question comes up, why do patients then develop an invasive carcinoma? And it became pretty much clear that cancers that develop through this mechanism have somehow to find molecular means to evade the attack of the immune system. And this again was systematically addressed by Matthias Klohr and many others in our laboratory. And we could show that there are a couple of known features in use. So for example, we found a lot of regulatory T cells being involved in these cancers. We found evidence that PD-1 is overexpressed, as is likely because these tumors can be nicely treated by PD-1 blockade. But one feature popped out that was quite important also for the concept of developing a vaccine, and that was the fact that about half of those MSI-positive cancers lose the expression of class 1 molecules, and this is because the beta 2 microglobulin gene by itself has two stretches which encompass the microsatellites, and they are again targets of this mutational mechanism, so that by mutating the beta 2 microglobulin gene, which is important for the antigen processing by class 1 molecules, antigen presentation can be completely lost. And we initially thought this is the worst what could happen to those cancers, because we expected that those lesions start immediately metastasizing, but the opposite was true. If you look then for patients who had developed microsatellite unstable cancers, who have lost the beta 2 microglobulin gene based on this mutational pathways, we never found metastases that were showing proficient or mutant beta 2 microglobulin composition in the cancer. So suggesting that the loss of beta 2 microglobulin and the loss of the the antigen presentation machinery by losing beta 2 microglobulin is the best prognostic parameter that can occur in these tumors, because obviously they completely lose their ability to form metastases. Quite important aspect, because if you think on vaccination, we might trigger the selection of those clones. Imagine you would teach the organism about the frameshift peptides. You would trigger a high number of cytotoxic T cells. You would expect that some of those emerging cancer cell clones, particularly in the Lynch conditions, would create lesions that have lost the microglobulin, beta 2 microglobulin gene, and this again is something that leads then to a local growth capacity of the respective tumors, but they completely lose the capacity to form metastases because of that lack of beta 2 microglobulin. So at the end, we hypothesized that the MSI induces the generation of these immunogenic frameshift peptides, and if we would trigger now sufficient number of T cells right in the beginning, then we potentially would be able to vaccinate at least Lynch cancer or Lynch syndrome patients into a state where the cancer can be resected if it occurs based on the other immune evasion mechanisms, but where at least metastases can be prevented in that setting. So to do so, we first had to start through the complete set of clinical development and regulatory stuff. Everybody knows here enough about this. And we had to run a phase 1 clinical trial, or phase 1-2A clinical trial, with two endpoints that we defined. One was immunogenicity of the vaccine that we used. We selected from the candidate pool three frameshift peptides that were representing about 98.5% of all potentially occurring MSI colorectal cancers. And using these three peptides, we initiated, with support of the company Oryx, a clinical trial in Frankfurt with Elke Jäger's group, and vaccinated patients with these three frameshift peptides, just as a peptide mix, long peptides, and monitored then the immune response and looked for potential side effects that were occurring. This is just a website where we explained for the patients how it works. And the outcome of that trial was that in all patients who were vaccinated per protocol, we observed a very strong induction of a humoral immune response. Everybody who was vaccinated according to the protocol actually developed a high titer antibody response, and the same was seen then for T cells. Virtually all the patients who were vaccinated developed CD4 cells. We used long peptides, remember, and some of them also developed a substantial high titer CD8 response against the respective vaccine peptides, clearly suggesting that the vaccination with these frameshift peptides is well tolerated, because the patients didn't develop severe side effects. Safety, immunological efficacy have been demonstrated in this phase two clinical trial, and now we have to see how we can proceed from here to develop this system into something that really can be used as a preventive measurements. And this is 90% of at least my duties, to look around where we find the money to really run a preventive trial, which is bothersome and hard work, as you all know. Thanks for everybody who was involved, particularly Per Borg's group, Johannes Gebert, who was very much involved in the selection of the antigenes and is now developing a mouse model for that, in particular Matthias Klohr, who developed the immune surveillance system in our laboratory, Elke Jäger, who ran the clinical trial in Frankfurt with her team. Thanks very much for your attention, and I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you for this exciting talk. Questions? Then I will start with the first one. Maybe I missed that. Why is beta-2 microglobulin deficiency linked to impairment of metastasis? Is there any functional role?
Very good question. We don't know. So we have started a couple of projects, so it might very well be that there are homing mechanisms in use, or that there are maybe cytokine effects involved. We have vague evidence that NK cell activity is triggered because cells that lose class 1 expression are prime targets for NK responses, but we don't have a definitive answer yet.
And second question, the peptides, the mutations you have selected for the clinical trial you just described, based on which criteria were they chosen? Is there any driverness which was sort of one of the criteria?
Yeah, driverness was the first criterion, and immunogenicity was the second criterion. So we actually used peptides from that we could expect that they are expressed in a vast majority of MSI cancers. And that they are involved in the pathogenesis and promotion or progression of those lesions, because losing those antigens would again be a harmful effect. So we were really looking out for drivers. Yeah.
Thank you. Further questions? No. So thank you very much for this exciting talk.